it's exciting to be here. I was saying yesterday that walking around the halls is almost like a reunion or a homecoming because I know so many people who work here. So I'm Jessica. I work in Wageningen in the Rural Sociology Group. My area of interest and expertise is in food security governance and food policy. So I did my PhD at City University, the Center for Food Policy in London, and then headed over to the Netherlands. And I'm really interested in questions of politics and power within policymaking processes. I really want to understand how we can organize policy or decision-making processes around questions of participation and to problematize participation and to understand where and how we can structure it to ensure particular voices are heard, what the implications of them participating are, and also what the outcomes are for policy. So part of this work is in progress. So I'm presenting it here as a way to build dialogue, something I've been working with Priscilla on and with other colleagues. I hope it can be maybe a bit provocative and a bit of a way to start a conversation. So as I'm sure most of you are aware, in 2015, countries of the world came together and endorsed the Sustainable Development Goals and Agenda 2030, with the second goal being to end hunger, achieve food security and improve nutrition, and promote sustainable agriculture. Woo, good. These are all things I think everybody in this room can agree on. And it's an admirable goal. It's a great aspiration. As a policymaker, right away a number of alarms go off. Because, and I'm sure as scientists, you're all thinking the same thing. These are very contested terms. These are very dynamic concepts. And how are we going to achieve this, and in what context are we going to achieve this? And one of the ways in policy that they try to negotiate or deal with these complex and contested issues is through participation, by bringing together a really diverse group of stakeholders. So we might see farmers with protesters or activists, entrepreneurs, scientists, NGOs, maybe even the affected, the hungry, all coming together to work on solutions or to consult or to give their opinions, a whole like range of types of participation. This has been a key strategy for making sense of the complexity of the issues that we're dealing with. And a lot of people have talked about this as the participatory turn in governance. And we see this in the form of multi-stakeholder platforms, which seem to be exponentially growing. In the Netherlands, we talk about the participation society. In the UK, you guys had big society. But we also see this in food policy councils, and also I think in scientific domains as well. And participation in governance has a number of benefits. You see, the research has shown that in many cases, the quality of decision-making improves. That ownership over decisions can improve, that people feel like they should be more invested in advancing the decisions. That there's improved accountability and transparency addressing questions of a democratic deficit. And a variety of views and experiences can be heard and taken up. And these are all great for me, from my perspective as a researcher. Where I get a bit uncomfortable is when, within these participatory processes, this diverse group of actors is told to come towards consensus. And this is the start of my sort of questions around participation and conflict. What does it mean when we ask multi-stakeholder partnerships to work towards consensus? First of all, it becomes very difficult because there is very little chance of consensus on complex and normative issues like food security. These are sites of conflicting visions and conflicting values. And I want to illustrate this by a grossly overly simplified example of the GMO debate. Now, in this room, we might have people who are in favor of genetic technologies, genetic modification, and others that are against. And I can find reputable, peer-reviewed scientific evidence to support both sides and to undermine both sides in the debate. We can all agree on that. Now, if we have two actors in the room trying to come to a consensus, let's simplify this. One is anti-GMO and one is pro-GMO, but they're closer to the middle. They're feeling okay. To get them to come to the center, to give up a few issues, that's not such a big leap, right? They feel like they can gain on some things and maybe lose on some things, but they'll come to a decision. And that in these cases, Maybe we can all get along. Maybe there's a chance for consensus. But when we expand multi-stakeholder partnerships, and when we see that people are actually farther to the extremes, coming to the middle is asking a lot. Coming to a consensus, and this is assuming the consensus is an equal consensus, which very rarely happens, right? Coming to the center is less likely. And what we see from both theory and practice is that people who are less willing to move to the center, less able to the center, are pushed to the extremes. This is a thumbs down because the implications of this are they drop out of the political system, political apathy, or they align themselves more fiercely with extreme groups. And we see this in these kinds of debates in food security and food policy, but we also see it, I think it's a nice theory to make sense of what's happening in politics today. When you think of the rise of populism, when you think of maybe what's happened in the United States around the elections, we have a long history of governments working towards the center, working towards centrist politics. And the result has been pushing people to the extremes where their voices are heard or huge political apathy, so no voter turnout. So what are the limits of consensus? It shifts quality, or it shifts our focus quality decisions to agreeable decisions. And maybe this is okay, right? Maybe agreeable decisions are good, but I think there are certain instances when we're talking about food policy or maybe agroecology for your sake, where maybe it's worth trying to get a quality decision. What we see from watching consensus processes is that they avoid topics and solutions that are prone to conflict. So there's a tendency to work on agreeable solutions. And that doesn't help us deal with the tough problems that we need to actually address. We also see that there's a very strong danger that power holders shape consensus. There's limited resistance to powerful actors within these consensus processes, and this can lead to, as I mentioned earlier, apathy, people dropping out. In terms of how these processes get translated to policymakers, there's a lot of evidence emerging that they place actually burdens on policymakers without corresponding social benefits. So there's not a lot of clear links between what people are asking for and how we actually translate that into social policy. Now, when it comes to food security, I put this in deliberately small text, you don't need to read it, but when it comes to food security, there's this idea that there is a consensus, at least around what we're talking about, when we come to a policy negotiation. And as we can see, this is a concept that has evolved over time. It's one that continues to change, and it's one that continues to be contested. So whereas 10 years ago, it was very common just to talk about food security, now we're trying to figure out, do we talk about food security, food and nutrition security, or food security and nutrition? And there are a lot of actors pushing for their own definition. Now, I raise this because within the idea of food security, although we can kind of accept it as a consensus frame, which is concept where it's very hard to find an immediate problem with. What we see is that there's internally within the norms of food security already conflicting ideals. One of the most clear conflicting principles that has been written about, especially by Jennifer Klass recently, is agricultural trade liberalization. So opening up markets, opening up trade, has been really presented as not only compatible but an essential ingredient to sustainability, leading some authors to talk about the tradification of sustainability. What this does is seeks to erase the contradictions that lie at the core of the objectives of sustainability and trade liberalization. So it's assuming that there isn't a conflict. And by proposing these relations as non-conflictual, the dominant framing of food security invites collaboration around a single problem, one that we can all get together and solve. And maybe I don't have to preach to convert it here, but it's more complicated. And I think the key example of where we see this kind of thinking coming to a head is in, for example, the Sustainable Development Goals. And if we look quickly at the Sustainable Development Goal targets for SDG 2, we see, trying to use the pointer, might not work. The target 2B is really about trade. It's about correcting and preventing trade restrictions and distortions in accordance with the mandate of the Doha Development Round. Those of you who follow trade will know that's been going on since 2001 without a conclusion, so curious that they're putting their eggs in this basket. And at the same time, we're trying to ensure sustainable food production, implement resilient agricultural practices, increase productivity and production that maintain ecosystems. Now, this is not to say that trade and sustainability can't be compatible, but there's very little research to show that the objectives of trade promote sustainability in their current form. So for now, in the way that they're framed, there do seem to be an inherent contradiction that we tend to overlook in our framing of food security. So within this sort of internal consensus definition, we see a win-win strategy emerge, which may not actually reflect the science or the political views that exist. By bypassing contradictions in discourse and objectives, the dominant food security frame eliminates debates. It restricts visions and values. Now, the logic of the dominant frame leads to a preference for non-conflicting framings, again, not allowing us to deal with the difficult issues that we have to start dealing with, some of the even more structural issues. And by avoiding or presupposing the absence of conflict, even within the definition of food security, we have reduced opportunities to highlight these conflicts. And this is where I make a case for conflicts matter. But my interest is actually not so much in the conceptual definitions, but in people's visions and how you bring people together. So why, then, should we make a case for recognizing conflict in policymaking? What we see when we start from points of conflict and not from points of consensus is that the problem boundaries are not taken for granted. As a group, they then have to define the problem boundaries. And as we all know, defining the problem is key to understanding the pathways forward. This moves us away from silver bullet solutions, which I think is key to actually making an impact with food security policy. We have enhanced learning through deliberation when we have conflict-based processes, or not necessarily conflict-based, but processes that acknowledge competing values, competing visions. We see debate over interaction and speeches. So if you've attended a policy process that is based on negotiation and debate, or that's based on public speeches, you see a very different quality of discussion and deliberation. What's important about organizing policy processes that allow for conflict to emerge is that you have to confront each other's claims and your own claims, and you unravel argumentation. So you may not come to agree with them, but you might start to better understand where they're coming from, and that's already a step towards improved decision-making. And it makes our implicit assumptions explicit, which is very, very helpful, especially also for scientists, as we tend to fail to do that adequately. And what we've seen is it can actually enhance political participation and engagement, because you get more meaningful participation and engagement that respects diversity. Okay, so how do we do this? What does this mean? Is this realistic? Is it possible? To answer this question, I want to first come back to the theory of post-politics, and then move forward from there. So the theory of post-politics, or the political, that I draw from in my own work is informed by a number of assumptions. First, as I already mentioned, there's very limited possibility of universal consensus on complex issues. We're not going to convince this guy that GMOs are going to feed the world. I don't think any amount of science, any amount of rational argumentation is going to convince them, because a lot of the positions that people take when it comes to policy are value-based. There's lots of conflicting value. What we also see is that when we push towards consensus, we can actually enhance antagonisms which threaten democracy. And that was that image I showed you earlier, where we push people to the extremes. Whereas if people feel that they're in their sort of away from center positions, have a voice and are heard, they're more likely to stay there rather than push up to the extremes. The second list of assumptions is that we need to start talking and training ourselves in politics. Now, politics is a process of opening out, of addressing conflict and disagreement. Politics is not everywhere from this perspective. So this is not a cultural approach to politics, where, you know, politics is everything. This is a very specific definition that sees politics in practice, in the practice of disagreement. At the same time, we see trends towards depoliticization occurring in policy processes. And this is where I think we need to start, again, reinvoking our comfort with conflict. Within global policymaking processes, and I think all policymaking processes right now, there's a real trend towards restricting the political, restricting politics. Conflict is suppressed in favor of consensus, in favor of dialogue, in favor of everybody getting along and coming to a coherent answer. What we see, though, is that this tends to reinforce elite interests and a neoliberal project. So just to be very clear on the concepts, we distinguish politics as this assemblage of practices and discourses that maintain order with the political, which is this dimension of antagonism that's inherent in human society, that there are just some fundamental issues that people aren't going to agree on, and that's okay. At the same time, we see this depoliticization. We see the elimination of political expression and dissent, and this is giving cause for concern. So the antidote is then obviously politicizing, and the question at the end is, how do we do that? I'm going to provide 5 steps. So I want to just draw your attention to 2 quotes. The first, Priscilla and I actually did the interview together, and I was struck by the words of a farmer activist and key figure of Flavia Campesina, who said, "We will not achieve anything without developing alliances and politicizing our work." And this was in the context of a totally different research project. So there's awareness from social movements of the importance of acting in a political way. While relaxing and reading Vanity Fair one evening on the plane, I read this other quote. "There's nothing more obstructive and distracting and unhelpful than to have a bunch of stupid apolitical family members calling the shots." A bit harsh, it's not my quote, but it's somebody from the West Wing in the United States speaking about the family of the president and the implications of apoliticalness. So I think these are very current issues that various actors in different levels of politics are dealing with. And just to be very transparent, what my own scientific interest is in looking and exploring these conflicts, these issues, is to try and understand this process of depoliticization that's been really well identified in climate change and sustainability science, but very much less in food policy. I want to understand the implications of depoliticization for food policy and identify mechanisms for repoliticization. So that's really my objective moving forward. So to try and make sense of this depoliticization and to make sense of the argument I'm making, we need politics. We need to be engaging in policy spaces that allow for diverse visions or conflicting visions of the world to be heard and to express themselves. Those are being eliminated by a number of trends in the policymaking process. With a colleague, Etsirad Elfourieux, we've identified at least 9 trends within agri-food policy that are pushing towards depoliticization. This trade-first mantra, this is the only way forward, trade-first. Tripartite regime standards, certification processes. Forum shopping, which allow particular actors to move to fora that better represent their views or their outcomes, rather than being forced to negotiate with other actors who disagree with them. What we're calling exclusive inclusiveness, so these inclusive multi-stakeholder processes where select actors are brought together. We could challenge the inclusivity of that. Processes that focus on consensus-based decision-making, as I started out with. Reinterpretation strategies, where actors take creative license to reinterpret particular policy outcomes. This call for evidence-based policies without problematizing what evidence and the conflicts across evidence. Basing governance on indicators, and the production of ignorance. Now, this is very much a list in progress. We've started trying to make sense of them in terms of various levels and to group them, and we're still playing with this. This is something if you have thoughts on, we'd love to hear, but yeah, we're seeing these happen at multiple levels, and we've identified a number of examples, so we're working through them. I'm not sure if there's any that are particularly of interest to this group. Maybe questions of consensus-based decision-making are my particular interest, but maybe in your own experiences you've seen examples of reinterpretation strategies where the understood sort of impact of the policy has changed. Or if you've been involved in these processes of building new foreign arena for policy discussions. We saw this a lot during the World Food Price Crisis, where there were four that opened up to be very participatory. And as a result, new four opened up with slightly different forms of participation, far more exclusive, but still being able to claim, you know, active participation. So what I want to now turn to is an actual practical case, a case I think a lot of, some of you in the room are familiar with. I know that a couple other people have presented on the Committee on World Food Security. What I've noticed in studying the Committee on World Food Security for the last 9 years is that there has been particular mechanisms in place that allow for conflict. So it's a nice case study to actually look at whether or not opening up policymaking processes to these more conflictual anti-apolitical processes actually has an effect and what the implications are for both process and for policy outcome. And I have to say that my particular passion is less the outcome and more the process. So I've tried to also include the outcome questions, as most people care about the outcomes. But as a policy wonk, I'm also just deeply interested in the process. So has anyone here not heard of the Committee on World Food Security? So I can breeze through these. Yeah, key thing is it was reformed in 2009 to be the foremost inclusive platform to work together to ensure food security and hunger. And this is the key thing that most researchers that you've probably heard from are interested in, that the composition of the reform committee will ensure that all the voices, or that the voices of all relevant stakeholders, particularly those most affected by food insecurity, are heard. It includes member governments, participants, including, well, I'll come to that, a high-level panel of experts, an executive, and an advisory group that informs it. And I can identify at least three mechanisms within the Reform Committee on World Food Security that allow for this conflict to emerge in a way that in other fora is actually suppressed. First is a commitment to tackle contentious issues. The second is the composition and functioning of the high-level panel of experts with Michelle is on. And third is participants with intervention rights within the meeting. So let's start with contentious issues. Policymakers do not like dealing with contentious issues. This is not their happy space. But within the development of the reform of the Committee on World Food Security and with the launch of this global strategic framework, which is a framework where they compile all the policy outputs, there's a commitment to dealing with issues that may require further attention. Now, Patrick will remember this was originally called the GAPS, gaps in the knowledge, gaps in consensus. And in the end, this was highly, highly controversial because countries couldn't agree what issues there was not consensus on. Think that through, yeah. There's no consensus on issues to which there were no consensus. So rather than calling them gaps, they decided to call them issues that may, very political language here, may require further attention. And getting issues onto this list has been really tricky. So these are some of the contentious issues that have been addressed by the Committee on World Food Security coming out of this list of issues that we may want to address. How do we boost rural development in the context of rural urban migration? International trade systems and policies. Highly contentious, especially to be negotiating a committee like this. The use and transfer of appropriate technologies. I'm sure all of us recognize the contentious nature there. Enhancing policy dialogue and promoting science-based decisions on biotechnology. These are not necessarily topics governments want to take on, but because of the participatory nature of the committee, they've been pushed onto the agenda and lobbied for. What are the hot-button issues right now in the Committee on World Food Security? These should not be hot-button issues. Maybe agroecology. Streamlining the rights of women and rights-based approaches, probably not, but they are. So in 2016, the Russian delegation included a declaration at the end of the final report of the conference stating they have disassociated themselves with paragraph 5 that contains an unagreed formulation on the centrality of human rights in the context of the Committee on World Food Security activities and the Sustainable Development Goals. This is an issue that we wouldn't necessarily on the surface think to be controversial, especially within a UN committee. But there's, because of the issues that they're tackling, a lot of controversy and a lot of conflict that's allowed to be brought up, and there's space for governments to dissent, to express dissent, and to engage with rationale for why and how their disagreement hurt. Now, we may not like this particular form of conflict, it may not sit well with us, but they have every right to do it, and it forces a stronger discussion. So they're not pushed out of the discussion, they're forced to sort of engage. Whereas in other issues, if Russia had a red line on the issue, you would not be moving forward with negotiations. So what are the impacts of these more contentious issues for policymaking? What we've seen is that the CFS functions best when they address niche issues. So they address issues that aren't being dealt with in other fora. So they did really well on land tenure and smallholders to markets. They have not done so well in terms of allowing for progressive policies to come out on trade, biofuels, and price volatility. This is not to say that the processes weren't conflictual, because they were probably more conflictual here than in other places. But in terms of how this current structure of addressing these complex issues or these contentious issues unfolds, is they do seem to have an easier time with producing policy outputs when they're dealing with issues that aren't dealt with in other fora. This is despite the fact that the CFS is supposed to be the place for policy convergence. So this raises questions about its influential nature, whether it has any impact. We see that also the niche issues can be very specific to the Rome-based expertise. So we see there's technical support for these issues like land tenure or smallholder markets. To date, there's little evidence to suggest that these policies are being taken up at the national level, particularly if we cut out the land tenure guidelines. So we don't see that addressing these more contentious issues that people are saying are important for them from a more grounded perspective. We're not seeing that actually translate back up in terms of what the CFS considers an indicator for success. The second place we see opportunities for conflict are in the structuring of the high-level panel of experts. Now, we have your director on this panel, and we also have the president of my university, who I think we can say have fairly opposing visions for agriculture. Maybe I'm wrong. The mandate of the high-level panel is to analyze and support decision-making on the Committee on World Food Security. What's important about this panel is it's bringing together diverse knowledges, so not only academics. There's also representatives of civil society. It recognizes that knowledge comes from diverse sources, so they're not strictly restricted to peer-reviewed science. They're allowed to look and bring in knowledge that's translated into other formats. And they're autonomous, which is important. They're not, the reports aren't politically negotiated afterwards. The reports maintain their autonomy. And they actually try to highlight scientific disagreement. So where you see a lot of scientific reports trying to come to a conclusion about the state of the art, they're allowed to say, actually, we don't know. There's these tensions here, and this is what this science says, and this is what this science says. And the first chairperson of the High Level Panel said, one of our key roles is to help members and participants understand why they disagree, which I think is a really interesting way to structure expertise and knowledge. So what are the impact of these reports? They feed into the texts that make up the policies. There are diverse and conflicting perspectives represented, but they have been ignored when they don't reflect the visions of particular governments. At the same time, civil society actors have used these really effectively to reinforce their positions in negotiations. They claim to have a widespread reach with their reports, so more than 10,000 results on Google. I did a Google Scholar and I didn't find the same results. So I'd be curious to sort of do a bit more analysis on that, about who's actually using these reports. And I don't know, maybe an indication of whether they're taken up into scientific reports isn't a good measure of their relevance. And the third and final area where we see conflict is in being able to emerge is through the issue of participation. And here we see that participation is really distinct within the Committee on World Food Security. Participants have intervention rights. So rather than being able to make statements at the end of the meeting, they're able to negotiate, inform decision-making, inform agenda setting, identify experts. So who counts as a participant? Groups from civil society, private sector, philanthropic, UN agencies, and research institutes. This is the traditional list. There's a new thing happening where other actors are being brought in, trialed as possible participants. So World Farmers Organization is now has a temporary seat on the advisory group. So there, it's a different perspective, raising a lot of questions about who represents farmers. And, World Health Organization and Scaling of Nutrition are other actors that are being tested about being brought in. With, we can ask a lot of questions about this, but I'll keep moving. In terms of conflict and being heard, I've been studying this from the perspective of civil society actors, and I think we can pull up at least two quotes from my research that really reflect the importance of having these spaces for conflict and dialogue. First says, our presence is important because we manage to bring in the real serious issues that big countries do not want to bring up, and this changes the dynamics. So by giving participation rights to different actors, we see a real opportunity to push these contentious issues and to ensure that they make it onto the agenda, which is something we don't see in other policy forum. Keeping issues on the agenda is the second point and related. So this is an example from a biofuel mandate, which did not go well for a civil society, but they said it was the only place where biofuel mandates, subsidies, and targets were discussed. In the G20, they talk about it for 20 seconds or 2 seconds. One country says it's a red line and the conversation moves on, and the CFS has stayed on the agenda until the very end. At least you have a space where you cannot be eliminated. And I think this is really key, that if we're going to reimagine how we do policy, and if we're going to commit ourselves to doing policy in a way that accepts particular voices, and if we accept that having a diversity of voices does allow for improved policymaking decisions, then we need mechanisms that allow for these conflicts to play out. And what we see is that when states are held to account, and they can't just say, no, we're not participating, when they have to defend their position, you advance, actually. You see advancements because you build trust and you build understanding, and then you can understand the barriers. And you may not win. That's not about winning or losing the policy process, but it's about improving the dialogue. So impacts of conflict, can we make any claims about whether this has had any impact, besides making a lot of people very frustrated and taking a lot of time? Well, despite it all, the CFS still functions. It's still been producing outputs. Now, I think there's a number of threats that's facing the CFS, but to date, it's still maintaining its mandate. We have seen evidence of enhanced deliberation and negotiation, leading to extra learning, extra trust, and improved understanding. So you see strange alliances between actors building. We see that arguably more relevant and legitimate issues are addressed, leading to more relevant policy guidance. At the same time, these processes are currently under threat. They're disliked by powerful actors. And if you go back to that list of depoliticizing practices, forum shopping was a really key depoliticizing practice. And one way to delegitimize these processes that don't serve powerful actors is to move to other fora or to delegitimize this fora in favor of others. And again, we have limited evidence that the policy recommendations are translated. So there's still a lot of work to do in pushing to see if this has any impact other than procedural. So to summarize, democracy thrives when various alternatives are put into discussion. But depoliticization is a continuing feature of neoliberalism, and that shapes our lives, our socioeconomic, institutional, and political. So how do we then go about being political? That's the solution if we aim to repoliticize. First is obvious, right? We need to ensure a diversity of views are represented. Now there's a lot of literature on what that looks like, what diversity means, how we sort of understand what is representation. The second point is that everyone, including, quote, extremists, have the right to speak. And this makes us, again, start to feel maybe a bit uncomfortable. What does it mean when everybody has the right to speak? What's important about extremists is they're not the ones, in this context, it's the people who don't conform. So the ones who aren't willing to sacrifice their values. And I think that's really important, to not have ones who are willing to give up. This agreement must emerge between traditionally entitled and traditionally excluded. So it's not enough to have disagreement between the European Union and the United States. There has to be, other voices there, which helps us deal with this diversity question. And disagreement has to be over the very nature of the situation itself. So these are sort of different ontological positionings. It's about the conflict over the assumed arrangement of things, about about the state of the world. And the key point then is that actors must agree to a common set of rules of engagement. For this to work, if we're following especially the work of Jean-Paul Mouffe, we need as a basis a set of ground rules that people then respect. And that's where this negotiation becomes tricky, and where I think the Committee on World Food Security that has an established set of rules is actually a nice case study for understanding whether or not we can have more conflictual arrangements in governance. So as my final few slides, how do we test the practices of being political in relation to the Committee on World Food Security? Well, if a diversity of views must be represented, I think there is strong participation of non-state actors, diverse knowledge represented on the high-level panel, and clear evidence that dissent is possible. It's less clear on who's missing and who is representing, not who is representing, but who is representing these particular actors. And maybe a bit more work and a bit more thought about representation needs to happen. In terms of extreme right, having the right to speak, we do see more radical voices are given the right to speak, and this includes not only civil society, but also private sector, and also governments. I think the statement from Russia was seen as somewhat extreme. However, these are mediated by particular mechanisms of selection. There are selection processes that mediate who can actually be in these meetings. And in terms of how the meetings actually work, some chairs are less open to hearing extreme voices and push not for diverse visions, but for unified voices, which puts a lot of pressure, for example, on civil society organizations. In terms of disagreement, we see that negotiations highlight clear differences between entitled and excluded. And this, what they in the Committee on World Food Security talk about as effective. I think it extends between not just civil society, but also states. We see clear battles between states. And there's tensions around right now who gets to represent farmers. I'm not sure if that actually fits there, but it needs to be somewhere, and that was the most relevant one. In terms of disagreements over the very nature, we do see disagreements over the sort of structural issues, like whether we're dealing with food security as a result of market failure, poor investment, weak technology, technology transfer. And we also, to the more weaker side, see that participation requires agreement on some value of a multinational process. We're already assuming, if we say the CFS is a good site for conflict and the rules of the game need to be set, they've been set in a particular institutional context that may or may not actually be appropriate for those most affected, and that may have an actual impact on how their voices are heard, or have an impact on ensuring that they become fluent in a particular mode of speaking or mode of operating that is perhaps less conducive to sharing their politics. And finally, actors must agree on a set of rules. As I mentioned, they agree on the rules of the reform, but new actors find these very challenging. You have diplomats coming in who don't appreciate being followed up by peasant movements, who don't appreciate being called out in the floor of the FAO. And there are strong efforts underway to undermine what's happening in the CFS. So what? I hope what you take away from this talk is that political participation acknowledges people are multiple. That we need a new configuration of power relations and governance processes. And these aren't all going to be friendly. This is not to say, rah, rah, we're going to get super progressive policies if we allow for conflict. It's not a normalist approach. It's really a sort of a democratic approach. And there's no possibility of final reconciliation when we're talking about issues like food security. So it's a call to do governance and communication differently. It's a call for us to be, even within our own centers, happy to debate. I think in the Netherlands, and I've seen from doing my PhD in the UK, that there's a lot of apprehension around disagreement, a lot of discomfort, and we're not trained to work through that. And I think that's actually a threat to science and a threat to democracy. And this involves, on our part as scientists and as people who live in the world, a great deal of reflexivity, and a great deal of self-reflection, pushing forward, and trying to find ways to make that work in our cultural contexts. Again, the impact of policies is not so clear yet. So classic social science answer, more research is required. But yeah, the summary is when conflict is suppressed, elite interests are reinforced, and we see extremism or apathy increase. That the value of developing these antagonistic or what Moose would call agonistic or conflictual relations, allows different views to be discussed and problematic issues to be raised in a way that we don't see in other fora. And this is under threat through the depoliticization of our governance processes. And I acknowledge process is not impact. But we need to find a way to defend these processes while remaining adaptable, and this remains very tricky. So how do we continue to test these sorts of policy models if they're not showing immediate impact? And this is something that we'll be working on. I think my time's up, so yeah, I'd love your questions, comments, concerns, feedback.
Thanks for a very interesting talk. I think it's a very important issue to bring out the conflict that happens in policy processes. I think it's very positive. I just want to ask about this, the different levels in policy development, the different stages. And your focus on the committee is very much that kind of strategic, aspirational kind of level. And I think from my sort of experience working in policy is that that's the level where it's easy to pull conflict in, because like you show in the SDGs, you can write into one strategy completely contrary or contradictory goals.
Yeah.
And it's acceptable.
Yeah.
But where the politics needs to happen is at much more of a practical level when you're actually constructing and implementing policy intentions. And again, in my experience, that's where it doesn't happen at all because of kind of a technical exercise.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering if you could comment on that.
Yeah, I think I've been looking at this at the global level, but also increasingly in the local level with local key policy processes. And I concur, it's really, really hard when you move from the aspirational to the concrete to the implementable to work through conflict. And the concerns I have is if we don't find strategies, then these do become technical exercises, but these are not technical problems, these are social problems, these are problems that require more than just technical expertise, in my opinion. They're problems that are value-driven and require political trade-offs. And so finding mechanisms to allow for, if not conflict in the actual policy implementation, but in the policy development phase, so having consultations that are aware of, that start from, these are the different competing views, rather than this is where we need to end up, is one strategy. I think the examples of participatory budgeting that we've seen in Porto Alegre, for example, have shown interesting examples of ways that conflict can be at least made visible. And then that can be translated in different ways, depending on the people present, to more operational outcomes, operationalizable outcomes. But I think this tension around, how do we repoliticize local policy making is the key question for me. Like, how do we ensure that the competing views go into these very local policy processes?
Just in particular research, is there any sign that the conflicts that are happening at the committee level are sort of allowed to filter down? I mean, are the sort of the groups that are raising issues at the committee subsequently raising issues at national levels? Or
yeah, I think
it's very difficult for them to do so, of course.
I think if we look at for example, the civil society mechanism, the people who are operating at the global level pushing, I think one of the key sort of provocateurs in this committee are civil society. And they're working at the global level, but a lot of them still operate with national and local campaigns. And there you see similar conflicts and similar lessons learned being shared, or similar experiences that allow to legitimize their positions and bring in alternative visions being translated. But in terms of the sort of conflicts that we see here trickling down, I don't think so. I would think it would be more actually the conflicts that we see at the national level trickling up, particularly in the way they organize case studies, for example, or in the science that they bring into the high-level panel experts. But I think it would be a bit, maybe other people who say the CFS here disagree, but I think it's a bit optimistic to think that the conflicts we see in the committee actually trickle down. Yeah.
Thanks, Jess. That's really, really enjoyable. I guess it kind of follows on from that question. I totally get how I relate to sometimes being more interested in process than outcome.
Yeah.
I wonder to the extent to which you can understand process if you separate process and outcome. So you said towards the end about there needs to be more work on representation, but I wonder if there also needs to be more work on performance, because if actually a lot of this to people to know that what's happening here is actually probably not going to make a difference beyond the forum in terms of people aren't listening to these documents and aren't enacting these documents? Does it then become possible to perform more, you know, sort of, whatever you want to call it, more, I don't know, more sort of distances and all of this sort of thing, because they're actually, they can do it in a space and then they can go back to their normal every day without like making a change. So I'm sort of wondering, perhaps in terms of how you're researching this, like what possibilities there for getting more sort of reflection from individuals. And also linked to that, the sort of idea of it would just be good to know a bit more about how fixed is the membership in terms of when new people come in, because you can obviously create this safe space where people get to know each other and start being able to sort of debate, discuss and argue and not get consensus. But if you then have to bring new people in all the time, do you have to start from scratch and everything with it? So just be a bit more to know that sort of those details around individuals and performance. And
On the issue of performance, I think that's a really excellent question. And I haven't looked at their level of like hope for the impact of the document, but my perception, having observed a number of these processes and interviewed a number of people involved in these policy processes, is they do believe these processes matter. I think most of them participate because they think there could be an impact at some point. So I don't know that, I think particularly civil society actors have a lot of vested in making sure this process continues, because it is the platform where they are heard, where they do have a lot more power and influence than in other forums. So I'm not sure that they would be deliberately conflictual for the performance of it. Although I think there's a lot to be said in terms of political strategy for being performatively political. Mm-hmm. And I think in the earlier days of the CFS, that was a really key strategy for social movements, was to be explicitly political. And then the NGO is playing a more technical role. But this, I think, leads into your second question about process and new people coming in. And I think one of the key threats to the, or challenges to the CFS has been people who weren't there with the reform, people who come in now 8 years later, 10, 9 years later, don't understand the process that it went through. And they just see this UN committee being overrun by young peasant activists. And that's the perception of a lot of people who come in. And I have done interviews with negotiators or diplomats who found it very, very frustrating, who didn't understand why, who did everything in their power to sort of undermine that process. And a lot of them at the end then come to recognize the importance of it. But there is this learning curve. I think one of the key, David Navarro came into the CFS, I don't remember if you were there, Priscilla Patrick, but he's the UN advisor for food security. And I think the first time he stormed out of the meeting after, because he'd been challenged by civil society in a very provocative way, a very political, conflictual way. And then 3 years later, he's singing the praises of the Committee on World Food Security because he got it. He got that there's need for that sort of political engagement, but it can be very embarrassing to the committee itself to be, for lack of a diplomatic word, pissing off diplomats, right? And I think that if the CFS doesn't do a better job of explaining the rationale of these processes, then they are going to, as we get farther and farther away from reform, as we get more and more actors not sure whether or not they should be participating, because there's a lot of key actors who aren't sure of how much energy to put into this forum, then I think we see more and more threat and less engagement. I don't know if that answers.
Yeah, my question links to the two previous ones. I mean, as much as I think it's important to have the CFS, and I followed in our teaching, you know, since 2008, we followed the reform and we're in touch with some of the actors involved in it, but is there any discussion that, in a way, it's also an elitist group in itself? I mean, is there any reflection on that? Because, yeah, you mentioned participation, so who can participate? Who can make it to these meetings? Who's represented? Yeah. And it's a really difficult question, but it's happening somewhere here.
Yeah.
At that level, and even if people bring it somehow to the grassroots, it's very difficult to bridge that gap. Yeah. And to local actors in different places really link to that. And if you don't see an impact, how can we measure impact? The fact that these discussions are happening is great. It's good to have it. But then there's this big but, you know, in the larger policy. And if it doesn't influence national policies, you can wonder. And but this group of people who have the funding and the resources to to go to these meetings. How does it make a difference? I mean, that's a big question.
It's a big question. I think in terms of elite policy spaces, I think most policy spaces are elite. When we talk about local politics and when we talk about national politics, these are elite spaces. Politics, policy making is a position of power, a position of high education. These are spaces that are not necessarily always conducive to people. Recognizing that, I think there's been a concerted effort to address the issue of how, if the vision is to have the voices of those most affected heard, then what does that look like and how does that happen and who's capable of doing that work? Priscilla and I were just talking, is it reasonable to expect farmers to be left, to be pulled out of their farms as much as well and participate in this non-effective necessary mechanism for their engagement? But what we do see within what the civil society mechanism has tried to do is ensure that their organizations, that people's movements support and legitimize speaking there on people's behalf. And many of the people are seen to be social movement actors, people who are connected to the ground. The conflict, I guess, is always that the more success you have at representing your organization at the international level, the more you end up working at the international level and the less connected you are. This is the cycle of the UN. So I think there's a trade-off there, and maybe there's work to be done around positions of leadership and how much circulation has to happen, but I don't know if that's for me to decide. I think that's really with the people's movements to make their own decisions around who can represent them and who has a legitimate voice. I think we can critique and engage with them on principles of representation. I think also in terms of policy impact, we haven't seen these policies being implemented at the national level, but we have seen civil society actors use them in their lobbying efforts at the national level. Now, do we need an entire global committee to produce outputs for civil society? I don't know. But I think that there is a lot of interesting, and Priscilla and I are now undertaking this evaluation of the civil society mechanism where we're going to be figuring out how much they're actually making use of these outcomes and is it relevant?
That would be really interesting.
Yeah, I think so. But what we do see is that there's hundreds and hundreds of people who come to these meetings every year. Some fund themselves and some are funded through this civil society mechanism, but they don't come for no reason. So there is a utility for them, and understanding that utility is what we're going to try and figure out. It's not clear to me, like, at sometimes, like, why are you here? Like, it is a question, right? Like, why would you leave your farm in Argentina and show up at this meeting to be wandering around the halls of the UN completely lost? Like, you know, what is the value for you? And people do have really strong reasons for being there, but yeah, I think we need to figure out.
You're talking about debate, and it just sort of made me reflect on myself and my abilities to debate, and which are really bad. And I
disagree.
I listen to a lot of podcasts. I'm going to refer to a story that I heard about, debate training in the US, which is all about speaking as fast as you can.
Yeah.
It's not really about debating, but it's about putting in so much facts that you can act like that's, I don't know how they mark these things,
yeah.
but that's essentially that the kids are going there, it's like blah, 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 blah. So I was, maybe it's not a question, maybe it's more a comment, but you were talking about inclusion and I feel that debate also, especially, I suppose at those levels, has a very white, I think white people, sort of facade where you have to stay calm, or where you have to have like some sort of dance and performance that sort of gives you a credibility within the theater of debate. You can't lose it, because once you lose it, you've lost.
Yeah.
So I sort of feel like there are these codes that one must learn to take part in these things. And so it ultimately will be impossible for people that are very affected by all these terrible circumstances in the world to take part, because they just I don't even know, I would be scared, or I don't know if, you know, if I would just get to a point where like, or not for, like, even hit someone, because, you know, you're just so pissed off.
Yeah.
Right? Which is what you're trying to say, like, you know, we have, and people's emotions can lead to violence, like, you know, to be old, like to be violent towards someone, and so.
Yeah, I think there's a number of really key points that I can try and reflect on.
Mm-hmm.
The first is the sort of whiteness of the event process, and I think that's a really important critique. And so, and I tried to bring up the need to reimagine ontological positions, and what is, how do you maintain people's ways of communicating, their understandings of problems in a way that translates to political debate. And I can tell you from my own experience as a researcher, it's been really hard to work with affected communities from my position as a white Canadian and understand their, even just their language in a meaningful way that allows me to translate it into policy thinking. So I think the key example I was giving my teaching is I was working and one of the participants was talking about how the wisdom of the potatoes, right, which was a really actually astute critique on climate change, that if you stand up at the United Nations and talk about the wisdom of potatoes and how the potatoes told you this, because there's a cultural and a sort of empirical connection to these potatoes, everyone turns their, yeah, nice story, you can go home and talk about it, I mean, it's a nice photo op, but it's not heard, it's not translated. And I think there's a lot of training to do in thinking about how we organize political discussions around learning how to listen for difference and learning how to understand different ways of being in the world,
mm-hmm.
to allow them to, quote, be affected, to speak in a way that's natural to them. Because I do think we lose out a lot when we transition from passionate political speech, which I said happened much more at the beginning of this process, to now what we're seeing as very astute UN actors still in politically recognizable outfits, so very traditional dress often, but working with the same mentality as now the UN process, which I think does then, it's a form of governmentality, it serves to reduce different visions. So I think this is a key question, and I think I'd love to do a research project. This is like, the one thing would be neat is, what happens when you bring decision makers to the field, right? With, and I think the FAO tries to do that to some degree, but if you don't bring the field to the decision makers and force those most affected to change their way of speaking, but you actually bring policymakers to where people live, I think you see a lot more, you get a lived experience rather than a being forced to mediate the conversation. I don't know if that's starting to, I don't know, it would be a super cool project, right? I don't know how we could do it, how you would analyze impact. It comes back to your question, something about how do you assess impact, but there's got to be a better way than having people sit in these large UN rooms. But I think that is, yeah, I think it's a part of thinking about depoliticization, thinking about how we reimagine relations around accepting conflicting visions of the world, and that includes conflicting experiences and conflicting ontologies, is really to find different ways of organizing how we communicate, and being really conscious of the sort of European burden of the spaces that we're asking people to come in and perform in. You had a second point, but I can't remember.
No,
it's okay.
No, was there any question behind me? No, I couldn't see.
Okay, well, I think we're also.
You were okay. So last question.
Last question.
You focused your presentation on what conflict would look like, or what role could conflict play in the process, right,
mm-hmm.
of the discussions.
Yeah.
But what would conflict look like in the outcome? Because, I mean, right now the outcomes look like policy recommendations or like agreed, usually policy recommendations for a number of actors. But could we, dream or think about an outcome of the discussion that would also enable conflict to appear? It could be like identifying red lines or identifying, you know, areas of disagreement, and like, because I'm unclear as to like what does conflict do if in the end you still have to agree on a shared list of recommendations or.
Well, I guess the whole point is that with conflict, you get ideally a more representative list of, at the end, or more maybe fair, more democratic list at the end, or more voices are put into it. And the list at the end would then, I think, necessarily not be as prescriptive as we see with, for example, the SDGs. And I think where maybe there's a lot of thinking to be done is indeed in terms of the outcome, how do we negotiate conflict? And one idea would be that different groups implement this in different ways, and that raises a whole lot of questions about coherence and policy and fragmentation.
But if you don't have prescriptions in your outcomes, like if it doesn't end up with saying, like, states have that obligation, or TNC should stop, whatever, like, forcing prices or, you know, unhealthy products on consumers, then what's the point of, like, bringing these people together?
Yeah, and I think it's about rethinking what we mean, if policy is to aim to a solution, or if policy is a sort of a more deliberative process that allows for solutions pathways. And I think the work that's coming out on reflexive policymaking is really trying to suggest that in the outcomes of our policy processes, we do need to have many more pathways, because there's just no consensus that's going to be possible on whether or not to ban particular products. And different groups are going to have very competing visions on what that looks like, which, I mean, then we get into a constant cycle, which makes me really uncomfortable as someone who is quite pragmatic, actually, in real life. So how do you translate this? But I think if we look back to the Committee on World Food Security outputs, we saw with the guidelines for land tenure, for example, that Coca-Cola and Pepsi, two companies that we all know, have adopted their own interpretations of these guidelines. And Livia Campesina and the IPC and other actors have adopted their own interpretation of these guidelines. So that could be an example where, and I would venture, having the analysis, I would venture to say there's some conflicting interpretations across those two actors. But they've taken the same set of outcomes and used them and adopted them in particular ways, which we can then, as academics, I think, play a really key role in seeing if they're holding the spirit of the negotiations and trying to analyze the implications of that. But that's, I think that's a nice example where a particular policy outcome has been used by a whole group of different actors in quite possibly very conflicting ways. But yeah, I don't know that this is the most pragmatic approach to policy making. I think it's actually not at all, but it's a challenge for us to start rethinking the sort of common sense of policy making and trying to undermine it in a number of ways to see if we can't structure it differently and think about different